I'm Jo Haig. I am a co-director of the Grantham Institute, Climate Change and Environment, here at Imperial College, and I'm absolutely delighted to welcome you all, both those of you that are from inside the college and outside the college, to engage in this very important discussion. So the Grantham Institute exists to support and encourage research into climate change and environment across the whole remit of Imperial College, that's science, engineering, medicine and business, and also, very importantly, to make sure that the results of that research is given out to the world, shown its impact, and any influence for policymakers is demonstrated. So the whole issue of divestment, whether or not it's a good thing to do if we want to have a carbon-free world, is clearly in our remit. So we were very pleased when two students from the Environmental Society, that's Johnny Richardson and George Richardson, who you'll see in a minute, came and said to us, you know, can we do something about this? And the result is the event today. We have a very eminent array of panellists, as you'll see down here, and they will be introduced in a minute, and we're very grateful to them for coming. This is a very important topic, and clearly some people already have very strongly held opinions, and that's absolutely fine. We hope that they will express the opinions openly and will engage in a proper rational debate, and I'm sure the audience will agree that this is what we're here for, is have a good discussion about all the issues surrounding it. The event is being filmed, but it's not going out live. It'll appear subsequently on our YouTube channel, should you wish to see it or tell your friends all about it. So I'm looking forward to a very interesting discussion here, and I'm going to hand over to George and Johnny, who will introduce the event.
Hello, so I'm Johnny Ritson. We're part of a growing number of staff and students at Imperial who are concerned about a lack of effective action on climate change, and we see divestment from fossil fuels as a first step towards this. There's been a lot of success in this movement around the world as universities and other institutions have agreed to divest from fossil fuels, and that's what we're here to talk about tonight. When we first started to look at what Imperial College actually invests in, we were quite surprised to find a number of companies which are actually banned from many ethical investment portfolios. Through a freedom of information request, we looked through what the college endowment invests in, and we were surprised to find that the college invests in companies implicated in things like human rights abuses, child labour and sexual discrimination, as well as companies which are involved in unsustainable environmental exploitation and which ban their workers from organising in unions. Frankly, we were very shocked about this. I think in a modern global economy, it's very easy to become detached from what you're responsible for. Many people will pay into a pension without really thinking much about it, other than looking at the statement at the end of the year. But I think share ownership is actually more involved in this. If you own shares in a company, you own part of that company, and what the actions of that company are done in your name, and you profit from them. I think there's many profitable industries in the world which we don't allow to continue unfettered because either they're damaging for human health or they're considered immoral. I think the tobacco and arms industries would be good examples of that. But I think in the future we have to start, when we talk about companies being immoral, we have to start considering what they do for climate change. The major oil and gas companies in the world have enough reserves to break the IPCC's target of 2 degrees of maximum warming. They have enough reserves to break this target, and yet they're still continuing to invest money to find more reserves.
So we feel like we could sit here and claim that institutions like Imperial College could be neutral and simply generate research for humanity and then sit on the sidelines. But this neglects the role of scientists, engineers, and medics as global citizens. And it's at odds with the current reality where many universities and other organisations are entangled with human activities which are causing a climate catastrophe. And so we feel that we should not be under the pretense that universities are neutral, and that we should take the responsibility instead to shift our position away from the system where corporations can invest in the destruction of our planet and we all go along with it. At the 2015 Grantham Annual Lecture, Mary Robinson, former Irish President and current UN Secretary General's Special Envoy on Climate Change, stated that the issue of climate change is far too important for politicians and negotiators. And so the question remains, what can we do to influence policymakers, fossil fuel companies, and the wider world? Now, we're not going to have time in 90 minutes to cover every issue which we could use to bring about systemic change, but we hope that this is a part of a new ongoing conversation at Imperial about our collective and active role. Divestment is really just the tip of the iceberg, but we think that it might be part of what could form a comprehensive solution to the climate crisis. We're looking forward to what all the panelists have to say tonight. We're looking forward to hearing your questions, and we hope you enjoyed the debate, and we'll hand over to our capable chair, Emma Howard-Boyd. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Johnny and George, for initiating this debate, because I agree with you, it's incredibly important to discuss how we look at our investments within our portfolios from a climate change perspective. My name is Emma Howard-Boyd, and I have worked for all of my career in financial services for at least 20 years on the asset management side, leading a sustainable investment team at Jupiter Asset Management. But for the last year, I've been having a range of different roles, sitting on different boards, and I'm here today wearing my chair of ShareAction hat. ShareAction is a responsible investment charity, and we spend a lot of time working with individuals and different charities, connecting them with their savings that are being stewarded by the asset management industry. And one of our initiatives is the Charities Responsible Investment Network, which works with a number of different environmental foundations, where again there has been an increasing imperative to look at the divest-invest debate, and work out what is the best response to tackling this issue within portfolios. And I know Susan will be talking a little bit about the work that she has been doing with her charitable trust in a short time. I think it would be useful for everybody on the panel if we could have a quick show of hands to find out how many of you are students, staff, and have come as guests to this lecture. So perhaps if you could put your hands up if you are students of Imperial College. Excellent. And staff, because again, there it may be through your pension funds that you're interested in this debate, and then outside guests. So fantastic. There may be some of you wearing, there seem to be more hands go up than, yeah. So, but I think that gives us a very good perspective of our audience. So thank you very much for that. And we're going to start off with short introductions from each of our speakers who bring very different perspectives to this debate, so I think we'll definitely in for an interesting discussion. And after that, we'll be opening up to questions from the floor. So that is your opportunity to ask about the positions that we collectively have taken in relation to the work that we're doing. So I'm going to ask James Randerson from The Guardian to kick off our discussion this evening, not least because of The Guardian's very high-profile campaign supporting the Divest Invest movement. And I think he's also going to touch on the slightly new direction it is taking in the run-up to COP21 just before Christmas. So James, over to you.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you very much indeed for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to have the opportunity to speak to you. I want you to cast your minds back to Christmas Eve. What were you doing? You were probably maybe wrapping some last-minute presents, having a glass of mulled wine, perhaps, or maybe even something stronger. I was doing all those things, but foolishly, I looked at my email, and in my inbox was an email from Alan Rusbridger, the then editor of The Guardian, who stepped down in June. And I didn't used to get that many emails from Alan, let alone, you know, on Christmas Eve, so I thought I'd better open it. And he was saying, well, you know, I've only got a few months left in the job. He'd emailed me and a bunch of other people at the paper, and he was saying, I want to do something impactful in my last few months, and I want to do something about climate change, but, you know, we need to work out what it is. And that began a whole set of discussions in the paper involving you know, not just the environment desk, but you know, the business desk, and all parts of the newspaper about what we could do. And we the point that we wanted to get across was has been touched on already, and that's the point that we already have way more reserves than we can safely burn. You can do the calculations and work out that something between two-thirds and four-fifths of the fossil fuel reserves that the companies already own or the or governments already own have to stay in the ground. Otherwise, we've got a pretty good chance of going over the two-degree threshold of warming, which is widely sort of regarded as the threshold for dangerous climate change. All sorts of impacts start before 2 degrees, but nonetheless, that's the point at which things get really bad. And that's even without the tens of billions of dollars that are being spent by companies prospecting for new reserves that we can't afford to burn. So we wanted to kind of make that point. But we also wanted to do it in a way that would give readers some sort of purchase on the whole thing, something they could do. And looking around, the divestment movement globally was just beginning to have a real impact. And for anyone who is sort of coming to this fairly fresh, the idea is you move your investments out of the fossil fuel companies that are doing that, taking the stuff out of the ground, and into other investments. And it's really a signal to say, you know, we don't accept the way these business models are operating. We don't think this is sustainable. It's not about trying to bankrupt the companies. It's about a signal, a political signal, if you like, that we don't want to be part of this. There are also some quite compelling financial arguments why, in the medium term, it's probably a pretty good idea too. But I suspect others will touch on them. So what we thought about this campaign was really exciting. Was unlike the sort of traditional approach to sort of a personal impact on climate change, you know, wear a jumper, turn down your heating type stuff, all of which is important, and, you know, we fundamentally are going to need to control demand. It just feels, you know, you can, by being part of a, you know, a student group or whoever it is, impacting on an organisation and persuading them to move potentially, you know, millions of pounds, hundreds of millions of pounds out of certain companies, you can sort of access a power that on your own, it just feels like a bit of a drop in the ocean. So that's why we thought it was exciting. And over, you know, the momentum behind that movement has just grown and grown and grown. It's absolutely astonishing. In the last few months, you know, we've had the Church of England, we've had the Norway Sovereign Wealth Fund, we've had loads of new universities in the UK and America. We've had, you know, the two largest pension funds in California. In total, 400 institutions, more than that, slightly more than that now, have made a commitment to divest, including The Guardian, by the way. And the total value of those funds, not the amount that's in fossil fuels, but the total value of the funds is $2.6 trillion. I think that's a pretty strong signal to the negotiators in Paris, and I think that's the real impact here.
Excellent, and perfect timing. So I'm now going to move to Bjorn Otto Sverdrup from Statoil, who's going to talk a bit about the fossil fuel industry perspective. Bjorn,
over. Yeah, thanks, Emma. Hi, good afternoon. I'm honored to be here at Imperial. Just so I'm going to say a few words about Statoil afterwards, but we actually, over the last couple of years, hired more than 80 of the students from Imperial College, and we're really grateful for that. And as you said, if you like to make a difference and even work with climate change from that side, we would really need a lot of talents also going forward. So that's a more of an invitation to all of you to join us in that. And also, I think it's a great opportunity to be part of this debate on the conversation on climate change and the divestment opportunity. I'd like to compliment James and their effort on putting attention to the carbon budgets and even running the divestment campaign, because it has spurred a lot of thoughtfulness among investors and also helped oil companies like us, oil and gas companies like us, to reflect even more how could we, what are the actions that we need to do to become even more relevant for a 2-degree scenario. So I think that's important. So maybe I should say a few words about Statoil. So we're a Norwegian-based company, but we have activities worldwide. We supply 20% of the natural gas consumed in the UK. So every fifth cup of tea or every fifth cup of espresso is brewed on the gas that we produce. We're a big investor in the UK. And not that many people know, but we do wind farms in the UK, supplying more than nearly 600,000 households in the UK with electricity. We're a listed company, but our biggest shareholder is Norwegian government, which holds around 67% of our shares. I think it's important in this debate. So clearly, we're an oil and gas company, and oil and gas is the biggest energy or biggest industry in the world. It drives the economy, it fuels the economy, and from everything from power, transport, manufacturing, oil and gas and petroleum, we find it nearly everywhere. The dilemma for most oil and gas companies is the following. How could we provide energy to a growing population of the world and yet protecting the environment and reducing the carbon intensity of the energy that we provide? Our response is that we need responsible producers, but I would like to add, we also need responsible consumers. But because have in mind, 90% of the emissions related to hydrocarbons happens when we use the products, consume them, either while you fly with a plane, drive your car, turn on the stove. So it happens in the consumption. So we in Statoil we don't debate climate science, we take it for granted and adjust our business behavior related to that. We believe we would like to be part of a rapid transition towards a 2-degree scenario, and we believe we can make a difference in making that happen. But it's a big task to really reconfigure the infrastructure, energy infrastructure of our societies. We cheer for more renewables, but still there will be a long period of time where we need oil and gas, because you know the equation doesn't add up. So that's why we believe it's really important, how do we produce oil and gas? So some of the things that we are doing as part of our climate agenda is to produce energy more energy efficient, as energy efficient as we do. And in Statoil, we take great pride in being the world's most energy efficient producer of oil and gas. We emit nearly half of what the other companies are doing when it comes to under production. And then to provide less carbon intensive energy. So more gas, less oil. And you probably know this, but if you run a coal-fired power plant, it emits twice as much as if you run a gas-fired power plant. So that's probably the easiest way to reduce emissions, by switching the fuel mix. We work to avoid leakages of methane. We do carbon capture and storage. We do close monitoring, reporting, and disclosure. We internally put a price on carbon to allow that to inform our investment decisions. And we also try to show a clear attitude, leadership, and we're not afraid of being part of the engaging in debates about this, because we believe it really matters. So what should you do? What should we do? Would you divest completely from this sector, or should you try to work with us? I guess that. So as I said, I think you made a difference with your approach. Pretty much like the environmental movement maybe 15, 20, 30 years ago. And it has also changed our behavior. So we have adapted some of the resolutions as a response to disclose even more information in our reporting. So next year we will be reporting what's the resilience of our portfolio when it comes to carbon pricing, carbon budget debate. But still, I think the debate kind of failed to distinguish between different carriers of fossil fuels. Not all fuels are equal. If you look at the statistics, coal is still on a growing path in the world. The world is still consuming more and more coal. And even in the UK, you're nearly flat when it comes to coal consumption. And I think maybe you should look at that in a campaign to see whether you can zoom even more closely into the real carbon-intensive carriers of energy. So in sum, we believe climate change calls for a change in the energy mix. We need responsible producers as well as responsible consumers. The carbon budget debate is a really worthwhile debate, but maybe the most constructive part or conclusion of that debate is more disclosure, more openness, because then you can get embedded into business risks and make informed investment decisions and choices. That's for now.
Great. Thanks. You very much. So we're now going to move more onto the investment side, and I'm going to start off asking Sagarika Chatterjee from the UN Principles of Responsible Investment to give an overview of what the asset manager and the asset owner part of this discussion is the approaches from those two parts of the industry.
Great, thank you. So just to start off by saying, really welcomed your words there, Johnny, and it's great to be part of your discussion here tonight, talking about kind of what happens next. Very briefly on who I am and who I work with, Principles for Responsible Investment is a United Nations supported investor initiative. And we have six principles on responsible investment. The investors that sign up to those principles are either pension funds, endowments, investment managers, investment consultants, research providers. We're not a trade association. I always need to kind of clarify this. We're an investor initiative. So just to touch on what is happening globally. So we sit in a really interesting place. Our head office is in London, but our investors are in over 30 countries around the world, and together they have about 59 trillion in assets under management. So the first thing I wanted to say was that the investors that we work with are taking action on climate change. And if you get a chance, look at this website called investorsonclimatechange.org. It tells you who's the more enlightened ones, what actions are they taking exactly. But there's very diverse approaches. So most recently, I think it was about 2 weeks ago now, HSBC Global Asset Management announced they would undertake carbon footprinting as part of their approach. CalPERS, huge US pension fund, has been very vocal in engaging with companies on shareholder resolutions very publicly, including with Statoil. And going forwards, they will be engaging with companies, again, via the AGM season, annual general meeting season, on the climate competence of boards. And then AXA, huge insurance company, they made a decision to divest from 0.5 trillion from coal, and that will be from companies with over 50% of their turnover from thermal coal energy, and electric utilities with over 50% of turnover from thermal coal energy. Well, why did they do that? A couple of reasons. One was they wanted to send a signal in the marketplace with those they work with and to regulators, and they also wanted to de-risk their portfolio and contribute to a safer society. And at the same time as that divestment, what was heartening to me was they made a 3 billion euro allocation to green bonds. We recently published a report where we conducted legal reviews in 8 countries looking at fiduciary duty. It's called Global Roadmap to Fiduciary Duty. And fiduciary duty is obviously absolutely sacred to investors. And the findings at a top level are that investors should take into account any material environmental social governance issues, including climate change. So it just shows you the kind of the direction of travel. So then, to touch very briefly on what we've seen are some of the downsides of divestment. As I think Bjorn and James have outlined, it's very valid. A couple of our signatories I've mentioned have done it, and it sends a market signal. The 2.6 trillion divested is truly a signal. However, there's a real economy out there, and our aim, as I understand it, is to stay within the global carbon budget. So we don't just want the money changing hands. We don't just want the assets being swiped up by private equity, buying it cheap, the coal assets. We don't just want the economy staying the same. We don't just want specific investment portfolios looking cleaner, but actually at the end of the day, we've eaten up the global carbon budget. And that's where I think a real change in focus is needed within the investment industry in shifting trillions into low carbon investments and identifying some of the barriers and overcoming those. And we need the engagement from investors with the policymakers on carbon pricing, phasing out fossil fuel subsidies. And we also need dialogue with the companies like Statoil on making the transition. And also the dialogue needs to extend to the workers in fossil fuel industries today who have contributed to prosperity, who need to see a just transition, as well as on areas where investors are less happy with some of the activities companies are taking, such as political lobbying that undermines a global deal on climate change. So if I look at the way forwards in transition, what does that mean? The best example I've seen of an investor in a university is University of California. So they are a signatory to the Principles for Responsible Investment. We work with them very closely. Their CIO is really bought in. They announced they would divest from coal. But at the same time, they've been part of the US government White House Clean Energy Initiative to try and get more into low carbon. And what they did was really interesting, and it's still a work in progress. They got together a consortium of investors to try and build a new intermediary to identify and assess some of the investment opportunities. And they've allocated $1.2 billion initially, and they're working with some of their peers like New Zealand Super and others. So I would like to see more going in that direction to really get the transition and to make sure we stay within the global carbon budget.
Excellent. Thanks, Sagarika. So I'm now going to hand over to Susan Seymour, who is a trustee of the Joseph Rowntree Charitable Trust and is one of the signatories to Divest, Invest, and is going to talk very specifically about how you and your fellow trustees have addressed the issue of divestment. Susan.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a great pleasure to be here, and like everybody else, I really welcome the opportunity and the initiative that has been taken to have this discussion. And I'm, as Emma said, I'm speaking as a trustee of a charitable foundation that has publicly said we're divesting. We haven't completely divested yet. I'll say a bit about that. Why did we do that? Well, a charitable foundation, we are a Quaker charitable foundation as well. We were founded by Joseph Rowntree, who made his money from chocolate. The Quakers in Britain decided to divest before we did. But that made us then sort of think, well, what should we be doing? So that was part of the pressure on us. But more of it was to be aligned with our grant making. Because basically we have a pot of money, and from that money, what it earns, how it grows, we give grants. And one of the major programs that we have is grants around climate change and around responsible corporate responsibility. And we just saw that it was a paradox to be making money, say, from the profits of the fossil fuel industry and then handing it over to campaigners such as There's one with a lovely name called BP or not BP, who are campaigning for fossil-free theatres, would you believe? But we also fund a remarkably successful outfit called Carbon Tracker. And what they've been doing is working out, you know, how much carbon we can still emit and how much of the fossil fuels that are in the ground need to stay there. And that has become a way of looking at this whole debate from a financial perspective. And I'm proud to say we were one of their early funders. But again, it would be a bit paradoxical not to then reflect in our investing some of the consequences of what they were telling us. So we're a foundation, we give away money, but I've been, all the time I've been a trustee, I've also been on the investment committee. And for many, many years, our investments have been, we've tried to make them ethical, we've tried in line with Quaker values, we've tried to make them socially responsible. We heard about the Divest, Invest campaign just after we made a big switch and we'd moved to a whole lot of new fund managers, some of whom just don't invest in fossil fuels because they're actually environmental solutions funds. But we'd committed ourselves to a three-year period with these new fund managers, and so we didn't, when we decided, yes, we do want to divest, we decided not to do it straight away, but to talk to our fund managers. And we've had an ongoing debate. We've also got involved in trying to measure the carbon intensity of our portfolio, because, as Bjorn has said, the carbon impact is not just in oil and gas, it's also in major emitters like utilities, motor manufacturing, and so on. So we've been trying to measure our impact. Where we are still in the fossil fuel industries, we certainly have shares in some of the big British oil and gas companies. We've been engaging with them, and we've been part of a campaign with other investors called Aiming for A, which has been trying to get the standards as high as possible. We've also were part of backing resolutions to BP and Shell last year, which their boards supported, to have much greater transparency about their fossil fuel emissions and their carbon reduction targets. So I think the thing that's the most challenging us at the moment is the invest bit of it. Where do we put the money instead? There are lots and lots of sectors. There's clean energy, there's energy efficiency, there's water efficiency, there's pollution control, there's sustainable agriculture. But all of these are rather different from what we've traditionally done, which is invest in large listed companies because they're new, they're startups, or they're in actual owning like a forest or something is a very different thing from owning. You know, they're much more illiquid. You have to buy them and hold them for a very long time. So that's been that's one of the areas that we're active on at the moment. Have I any more time?
You've got 1 minute.
Okay. Well, then I'd like to tell you a little bit about some of the other groups that we're involved in funding that I would encourage you to have a look at. One, particularly for the students here, there's a group called People and Planet, which is a student-led group, and we're funding work they're doing to rank universities by their connections with the oil and gas industry. So it's not just where they invest, but where do they get research funds from, who endows their chairs, who gets the names on their buildings and so on. So that's quite an interesting thing to look at. There is Influence Map, which is a website which has apparently recently done some research that shows that half the world's largest industrial companies are in obstructing climate change legislation, and you can find out from their website who they are. There is ShareAction, who are doing marvellous work to get people to be aware what their pension funds are up to and trying to get pension funds to be more responsible. I think I'll stop there.
That's brilliant. Thank you, Susan.
And last but not least is Howard Covington, who has a number of roles, but until relatively recently was the chief executive of Newstar Asset Management. And I think it's fair to say, Howard, when you were at Newstar, climate risk wasn't something you particularly focused on in the portfolios that Newstar was managing. But since moving on from Newstar, you've spent quite a bit of time looking at this issue, and you're going to talk about forceful stewardship and some of that work now.
Okay.
Howard.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It's a great privilege to be here. As Emma said, I used to run an asset management company. I was an investment banker before that. I now run a couple of maths institutes, one up in Cambridge and one here in London. And I spend some time doing stuff on climate change. Before I get round to what Emma asked me to talk about, let me talk about what I'd like to talk about first. So here is, if you like, a complete outsider's analysis of where we are. So we've built our fabulous civilization on fossil fuels. We've discovered that continuing high emissions pose a significant systemic risk to the climate, potentially to the global economy, and beyond that, if we go far enough, to social stability. But we are very, very smart. We've very quickly developed wind and solar power and got it to the stage where it is economic and about to take off rapidly. We know how to use nuclear, we know how to use hydro, we even know how to use carbon capture and storage. We know that what we have to do to lower the systemic risk is to decarbonize the world economy very rapidly on a timescale of a few decades. We know we can do it. We know we can do it and maintain growth. So, I mean, there isn't an economic or a technical problem here. What we have to do is bring about a rapid energy transition. And as George said, we are global citizens. It is in all of our interests, and especially you younger people, to bring this about as quickly as possible. But it's not in everybody's interest to do that. It's not in the immediate interests of the fossil fuel companies. Their shareholders are invested in them because they want to make money out of fossil fuels. So they put an obligation on the directors of these companies to run them to make money. And of course, that means prolonging fossil fuel use into the indefinite future. They have a fiduciary obligation to do just that, and they are doing it. It is well documented how they have postponed taking action and tried to muddle the clear arguments about this. And if one listens to their chairman when they go to Davos and discuss the world economy, one by one they talk about the use of fossil fuels increasing at around 1% a year for the next decade or two decades, when we know to bring about a rapid energy transition, fossil fuel use or emissions have to come down at 3% a year. I mean, the gap between what they talk and what we need to do is very large indeed. So what can global citizens do about this? Well, what you might think of doing is asking the people who look after your money, your pension funds, your university endowments, your insurance policies. You might ask these people who own the fossil fuel companies and indeed own all the other companies who make carbon emissions to change what they're doing, to write business plans, to reduce their emissions in a way which still makes money for them, but is consistent with the world on a 2-degree trajectory rather than the trajectory we're on. The problem is, if you did ask fund managers, pension fund trustees to do this, with a few highly enlightened exceptions, such as Susan here, you would find that they couldn't care less. What they would say to you, in a very understandable way, is that they're very busy doing all the things they're doing, They have quarterly performance statistics to meet. They have a huge amount of legal obligations to meet. A chief executive of a very large asset management company put it to me like this: we don't ignore climate change, we just neglect it. And that's where they are. So I have been encouraging investors, pension fund trustees, asset managers to use their votes, to vote for resolutions for greater disclosure, for resolutions to for companies to publish business plans, to say how they could run their business consistent with a two-degree world. It is a long, hard slog. I would encourage you to do that with your pension trustees and with your university endowment managers, but I don't think you will get very far. I mean, this is quite a sophisticated sell. So that brings one to divestment. You can encourage your pension funds or your endowments to divest. Now, in economic terms, in one sense, this doesn't do anything. Somebody sells, somebody else buys, the company goes on doing what it's doing. But in a broader sense, it does achieve something. It stigmatizes the fossil fuel companies. It says publicly that the funds who are divesting are thinking of fossil fuel companies in the same way that people thought about tobacco companies. They're doing something which is antisocial and they should stop, or they should mend their ways, they should be constructive about how to reduce fossil fuel use and not try to prevent that happening. So if you ask me, what I would suggest that you should do, especially the younger people in the audience, it is vociferously to encourage divestment and to make a lot of fuss about it.
I'm done.
Wow. I'm not used to you keeping to your time. So that is fantastic. And what a call to action. I'm going to ask a few questions of the panel before opening it out in a few minutes to the audience. So please get ready with your questions. But I did want to, is that a dog getting very excited? I did want to start off by asking for some comments on the Mark Carney's comments last week to the insurance industry from a Bank of England's perspective. What is really interesting from Howard's point of view is he has come from a mainstream position around investment to bring his experience to think about climate risks within portfolios. And I think there's no doubt in my mind that Mark Carney speaking, was it last week, about climate risk has again, it's one of those significant moments of putting this agenda very much in the mainstream. So if I could ask for some initial comments on that. I don't know, James, I know The Guardian's covered this quite a bit, but any thoughts from the other panelists?
Well, yeah, I mean, he is, you know, no sort of sandal-wearing Guardian-reading type, I suspect. I don't know, maybe he does read The Guardian, but he's coming at it from a very hard-nosed position, looking at the risks, the financial risks posed by the climate, and he broke them down into three, and one of them was certainly the risk of, you know, impacts on infrastructure and so on from extreme weather, but the most important one was really from the point of view of this discussion was the risks posed to companies that make up a large proportion of the world economy in the FTSE 100 by action on climate change, if you like. So if the negotiators in Paris get serious and actually start making things happen and the transition goes in that direction, then the assets that the value of these companies is based on, the reserves that are under the ground that they've earmarked, much of them will turn out to be worthless. Those assets will be stranded. And so you know, the financial argument for moving your money is also very very compelling, because in particularly if you're a pension fund that is, you know, investing for the very long term, you know, this is not going to happen overnight, but one imagines that you know, at some point it may happen quite quickly. So yeah, I think it was very, very significant that he, you know, he made that. I mean, he'd sort of prefigured that statement, but it didn't sort of come out of nowhere. He'd said, you know, we think this is a risk and we're going to do some serious work looking into it. And that was kind of the result of that report, I believe. But also, you know, Jim Kim, the president of the World Bank, has made similar types of statements, and I think the financial community is really starting to wake up to those, to these risks now, and it's sort of taken a while, but it's certainly the case. If I may, do you mind if I just mention, because I promised to say something about the next phase of the Guardian's campaign, I actually forgot to in my opening remarks. So we are, one thing is that we're teamed up with 350.org, who are the NGO that originated in the US that are really the engine behind the divestment movement worldwide. And on Monday, we launched sort of phase two of the campaign. Earlier on, I tweeted the launch piece, so if you're interested to hear a bit more about what it's all about, you can find it on my Twitter feed, James_Randerson. But we, in our second phase, we wanted to kind of look at the other side of the coin, so really the sort of investment side of the coin, if you like, in its broadest sense. What's going on out there? What could one put your money into, if you like, that is making a difference? And in particular, we're going to focus a lot on solar power, because we think there's a huge amount of activity there that's very exciting. The costs are coming down incredibly quickly, and you know, and that will sort of sweep away some of the arguments, I think, because people will just want to put their money into solar power because they'll make a lot of money. So if you go to that article, you can sign up and receive lots of updates about what the campaign is doing and so on. So I very much encourage you to do that.
Great. Sagarika, I think you wanted to comment on Mark Carney.
Yeah, sure. So I think some of the backlash to Mark Carney's comments were about, you know, what's a central banker doing talking about these kind of issues? He should just stick to the job at hand. But actually, if you read his speech and then look at the Prudential Regulation Authority's report, the Bank of England has been very, very careful in sticking to its remit. And I think Mark Carney's words were, it's not his job to be driving the transition. That's not for him to be doing. But it is within his remit and within his job for a policymaker to be thinking about what are the frameworks that can help and doing a proper risk assessment. And some of the very large mainstream investors that I have spoken with within the UK and also outside the UK were really pleased to see the speech and the report coming from Mark Carney, well within their kind of remit. As policymakers, investors that we work with have been engaging for some time trying to get policymakers to get these kind of issues on their agenda within their remit in an appropriate way. So we really welcome the Prudential Regulation Authority's new report. And one of the components within that that's raised is about company disclosure. So one of the initiatives that Principles for Responsible Investment is involved in is called the Montreal Carbon Pledge, which is a commitment by an investor to measure and disclose carbon footprint of their portfolio. So for that to be done, investors need the information and the disclosure from companies. So his speech was a sign of the times, and I think it will be very much welcomed in time by more investors.
Susan, you wanted to comment?
Just to really come in as a grant rate maker rather than an investor. Mark Carney mentioned Carbon Tracker. So when we're evaluating the effectiveness of that grant, I think the multiplication factor will be in their favour.
That's fantastic to hear. I think the other comment that Howard touched upon was fiduciary duty, and I think this is an area that is often referred to by trustees as something that prohibits taking a more responsible investment approach. Again, Susan, in your work, how have you gone about putting fiduciary duty, not aside, but I suppose you almost using fiduciary duty and aspects of fiduciary duty to underpin the sort of stance that you're taking?
Well, I think it is actually rather different for the sort of foundation that we are, because we don't have liabilities long into the future that we have to meet like pension funds do. And if you're a trustee of a pension fund, you've got commitments up 30, 40, 50 years ahead. We have, as a as a charitable foundation, we could spend all the money next year if we wanted to. It's just something that's just been so obvious to us for 30, 40 years that investing responsibly is part of our overall mission, and we can't invest not in line with our mission. And I would suggest that any asset owner, whether they're a pension fund or a university endowment, you know, need to start with, you know, what is our mission, and then how develop an investment strategy that fulfills the mission. And that will then be in line with the fiduciary duty. But there's been a lot of myths around saying that, you know, charity trustees, their only obligation is to make as much money as possible, and that just isn't true. But it's a myth that is very hard to dislodge.
Howard, do you want to come in?
Yeah, the fiduciary obligations of pension fund trustees, other trustees, it's a very interesting topic. The Law Commission reported on that in, I think, 2014, and was absolutely clear that investment fiduciaries, those who manage money on behalf of somebody else, have an obligation to make investment returns, but also to control for risk. Now, climate change is a systemic risk, and it's possible to do a calculation to work out how big that risk is. And the result of that calculation is something like this. If by the end of this century, by 2100, we come out in the worst 5% of cases that are considered plausible, both in terms of warming and damage, the risk that is already included in the value of a pension fund is about 10%. In other words, if you factored in the worst 5% of plausible outcomes, you would reduce the value of the assets of a pension fund by 10% now. That risk is increasing by something like 0.5% a year. So it's quite an interesting question. If one can do a calculation like that, and one can, and it's not that complicated to do, it's a very interesting question of what pension fund trustees and asset managers are doing to manage that risk. And if they're not doing something that is explicit to manage that risk, then they are complicit in seeing that risk increasing. And they do have legal obligations not to be complicit. It's kind of interesting.
And I think some of the legal advice that has increasingly been given to, again, charitable foundations and endowment funds is that the trustees also have a fiduciary duty to look after the reputational asset of a charity. So if, like the Joseph Rowntree Charitable Trust, you are investing in a certain type of, if you are making certain grants supporting environmental issues and not having that alignment within your portfolios, you are potentially putting your reputational asset at risk and damaging that. And we've seen on different issues, charities very much in the headlines for having within their investment portfolios investments in the sorts of companies that their grant-making activities are trying to
prohibit through development work or other such aspects. So I think that whole enhancement or of thinking around fiduciary duty has given a greater number of trustees a bit more comfort that making these sorts of alignments is the right thing to do. Bjorn, we haven't heard from you for a little while from the oil industry perspective. Particularly, you welcomed the campaign that The Guardian has been working on, but I'm particularly interested in your reflections on some of the comments from the investment community and how you feel you need to be engaging with your investors on climate risk issues, or whether that's changed any of your thinking.
Yeah, so thanks. I think we have a kind of nearly a rule of thumb: say what you're doing and do what you're saying that you plan to do. So that's what we're up at. So when it comes to, I think you ask, make sure that the industry at least doesn't, through its lobbying, undermine the international movement or the UN climate agenda. I think we at least forcefully embrace that and hope to see a efficient and good agreement in Paris in a couple of months down the road. We have adopted the resolution that you asked us to do, to disclose even more. And then I think there is, that might be helpful for this debate, is to, because there are some concepts out there that we could, or terms being used, and that is the distinction between resources and reserves. I think it's helpful. So in oil and gas companies, we have resources. So for instance, imagine an oil field and we can probably recover 30, 40%, maybe 50% of the oil gas in place. So we, in the total oil and gas and volumes in place, we call resources. Where we have plans to develop them, we call them reserves. So in the industry, we are more than used to having stranded assets. So they could be stranded, or meaning they won't be developed. Out of geographical reasons, they're just too remote, or there's a lack of infrastructure, or it's simply too costly. So that's why we are exploring. It's not because we don't believe it's not oil and gas out there, but we're looking for developments that could be cost efficient, that could help bring affordable energy to the market. Maybe we can leverage existing infrastructure. And even we could do subsea developments instead of building top sides with much higher energy efficiency. So that's why we continue to look for new deposits, so to speak. And it's also, I think, the distinction between resources and reserves is very important when you understand the valuation of companies. So when investors are looking at what price should be the relevant share price for Statoil or whatever other company, they will be looking at the reserves where we have plans, not necessarily the total resource base. And if you look at the global level, I think most people would say, yes, there is abundance of hydrocarbons, mainly because there's so much coal around. But there's less oil and less natural gas. So I think the debate will actually improve if we have a bit more granularity around some of these facts.
Great, I'm going to open out to the audience. So hands up if you've got questions, and I can already see a lot. Whilst we're waiting for microphones, is Hannah Edwards here? Hannah submitted a question earlier. Hannah in the middle. So can we get a microphone in the middle? And then, sorry, can you keep your hands up? So if we bring the second mic down to the gentleman in the blue shirt. Hannah.
Hello. So my question was around if you think that the divestment campaign can really influence energy companies' policies, or whether it's more of a mechanism for encouraging people to discuss the issue.
So the focus of divestment. Can we take your question as well? Because I'm quite keen to keep the pace going.
I'm Andre and I work with Community Reinvest, NGO exactly interested in exploring the investment options. And we heard about Statoil, we heard about...
Can you speak up?
Oh, maybe it's not coming on. Hello? Hello? No? No. Just speak loud. Okay. So we listened to Stack Oil talking about all the cute initiatives and how they try to move towards a low carbon economy. And we also listened to Howard Covington, how he says there's a big gap where we have what they say, and we have like all these small initiatives, and we have the figures that tell us that we are still increasing our emissions every year, and that we are not on track to our goal. We're not even in the direction to our goal. So there's this big difference, and this just hints to what we should have before, that looks like a systemic failure. Our energy system is failing us in the way that it provides what we want to provide for us. And the dimension I would like to add is that we need to think, if we think about reinvestment, we need to think in what kind of energy system do we want for our future? And I think that is an essential question. And I think we should mind that our energy system at the moment is not only failing us with respect to blowing carbon emissions into the air and even every year increasing the carbon emissions, but it's also failing us on other issues. We know about fuel poverty in the UK. We know about energy system which is controlled by the big six, by big companies with little democratic control. And the question therefore is, how do we get on track for a fair democratic, like for a fair energy system? What is our vision for a fair and democratic energy system, and how do we get there? Because I would argue that in a fair and democratic energy system, there's no space for multinational oil and gas companies, which have a track record of environmental crimes and human rights abuses. And yeah.
Great. So two quite big but related questions. One around, is divestment really having an influence changing the strategy, and also that the role of moving towards low carbon energy. Bjorn, do you want to start off?
Could I just first say comment to your question? I agree, we're not yet on track to the world is using way too much carbon. So, and I think we haven't seen the change that we would need. So I agree to that point. So will they? Clearly, I think the discussion on the carbon budget has been very important because it's raised awareness. And then what is the better strategy? Is it to be part of the discussion to really get inside the production of energy, help make daily decisions, or could we do this differently? Could we invest more money in this side? Could we improve that business case to accelerate our kind of shift towards more renewable energy? Or would you like to say, I'd like to go elsewhere? I think it's nearly a personal choice, and I know I am where I am because I believe I'm much more impactful working inside the companies, trying to shape the future of energy. And also, we have even a very bold ambition that we'd like to help transform and shape the industry at large. So, yeah, that's the invitation, actually, and we're approaching that in a way that we don't know all the answers. We know that what has brought us here won't take us to where we should be in 10, 20 years from now. So we need change. And for us, it means looking at how we do the existing business, but also how we build research, technology, innovation to take us to both the new sources and also very different ways of looking at our energy systems. Partly of what you're talking about.
Howard, do you want to come in? James, do you?
I could take the first question at some point.
Yeah, okay. So Howard, you go next, and then James.
So can divestment influence policy? The answer is yes. No company chairman likes to hear that great universities and great foundations won't touch his company with a barge pole. That's not a nice thing. So it does certainly influence, even though the fossil fuel companies will deny that it does. On the energy network, so there has been a proposal quite recently for a kind of Manhattan project to come to grips with the problem of large-scale electricity storage. That is certainly something that the world should do. We should massively increase the research and development budget for energy storage and spend it at universities just like this one. But that doesn't solve the problem. I mean, that would help enormously with energy, but then there's industrial companies generate carbon emissions through all sorts of processes. We've got to get carbon capture and storage up and running, or we've got to re-engineer the industrial processes. There is a huge amount to do, and a huge amount for people just like you to get it done.
James.
So does divestment work, and how? And of course I would say yes. I agree with Howard. It's about making the business models of those companies, the action of going out and spending investor cash looking for more fossil fuels that we just simply can't afford to burn, making that an unacceptable thing to do. And in the process, you make those companies... you reduce their sort of social license to operate, you reduce their lobbying power, you diminish them in some sense. So it's a political action, but also, as Howard says, it must impact on the way they act internally. It, once you get to the stage where you've got, you know, 400 institutions around the world taking and growing, taking those decisions. So it's about sending a signal, but it's not just about the companies changing. It's also about influencing politicians as well. And you know, it's very hard to kind of attach any changes to to divestment decisions, if you sort of mean, because you know these discussions happen behind closed doors. But I mean, it was quite striking. I think it was last week that Shell took the decision to pull its Arctic adventure, which had, they'd basically spent $7 billion burnishing their, achieving really nothing apart from burnishing their credentials as you know, going in the wrong direction on climate change, I guess. All of the protest around that, I think, it was clear internally that they were kind of taken aback by the level of protest around all of that. So I think, you know, these actions do have an impact. Just one other point, we in the first phase of the campaign, we were trying to influence two organisations which so far haven't taken the decision to divest. They are the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, who have $32 billion investment fund, and the Wellcome Trust, who have an £18 billion investment fund. So they're very big players, and they're both health charities, essentially. They invest in healthcare and, they give grants in healthcare and health research and so on. They understand very well the impact of climate change on public health. So we were making that argument that, you know, on the one hand, you're giving your money to try and help things over here, but at the same time your investments are acting against them. And the argument that we had back from the Wellcome Trust was that they didn't want to divest because they felt they had more influence on the companies internally, which is an interesting point, and I know there may be some disagreement on the panel on this. I mean, we took the view that if they are having some influence, we'd like to know what it is, and they should be more transparent about it, but they were not really able to give any examples. And it just felt that if those discussions are happening behind the scenes, they're simply not achieving things fast enough. And so the only thing you can do really is say, well, we're going to pull out until the companies change your ways.
Great. So I've got two microphones out. Can we have two quick questions rather than statements? Because then we can get as many of you, your questions out.
Okay, I'll try my best. Paul Zakor, I'm a consultant. I do wonder what I have wondered for a while what the purpose of divestment is. If it's to victimise, sorry, turning into a statement, but there is a question, I assure you. Is it to victimise the oil and gas industry and put the spotlight on them? And I've often wondered what the reciprocal of that is, and I'm glad to see the hashtag is now divest and invest. And you mentioned the solar investment campaign of The Guardian, which is a noble cause, I'm sure, but I just wonder if that's sufficient to absorb the sort of capacities of money we're talking about and the financial flows that need to be unbundled from the fossil fuel sector and put into clean energy. And on that point, I wanted to mention that this week the Climate Action Tracker just published the latest analysis of the INDCs going into COP21, and there was a figure of about 2.7 degree pathway we're on, which I found actually quite positive. Some people said, well, it's not 2 degrees, but I thought 2.7 was quite an achievement. But what we see with those INDCs is huge telephone numbers in there about the levels of investment they're contingent on. And we see the GCF, the Green Climate Fund, with its private sector facility coming off the ground. And I wonder whether somehow that divestment campaign can link into that need to get private sector money flowing into investment in low carbon technologies in developing countries today through things like the private sector facility. Is that a serious investment proposition for large investment houses in London today, or is that just pie in the sky? That's my
Great.
Question.
Second question here.
Statoil's website says that you strive to explore, develop, and produce oil and gas in the Arctic. So how do you see that exploration for new reserves is compatible with the 2°C goal that you support?
Great. So I'm going to ask Sagarika to start off with the first question.
Sure. So I think the key words that really come to my mind are about orderly transition and that is what we need. So, you know, just coming back to some of the earlier questions on divestment, does divestment have a role? Does it influence policymakers? Sure, it does. But policymakers that we've engaged with are interested in an orderly transition. So coming back to the low carbon question, I was speaking on the phone yesterday to a large Nordic investor. They are a long-term investor. They have private equity investments, clean tech investments going over 10 years, but they can't scale that up any further because it would put at risk savers capital. And their view was that we need the new technologies to come through, but there's a real funding gap between the kind of a startup phase and what a large asset owner pension fund can actually invest in. And that's where I think the policymakers could have a role in trying to encourage those right investments happening. But that's about transition. And that, to me, is the really key point here.
And Bjorn, would you like to answer the second question, please?
Yeah, and I think it's a very good question. The background is that, you know, any oil and gas reservoir, there is a natural depletion over time. So if you look at the world average, I guess it's like 5% depletion. So we're running out of production from the existing fields. So in order to meet the world's energy demand, the growing population would like to consume more and more, we need to continue to discover quite a lot more just to stay flat or even decline. So remember, even if you have an exponential growth of the renewables every year for 10, 20 years, in most scenarios, renewables won't take more than 10, 15, 20% maximum of the world's energy mix. So that is the challenge. So that's why we continue to explore. And then why do you do the Arctic? Well, for starter, we do the ice-free Arctic up in the northern part of Norway. So it's a kind of a proven existing petroleum basin already. And remember, most of European natural gas consumed in Europe is already sourced from the Arctic, Russian Arctic, and the Yamal Peninsula. So it's around.
So Howard, a brief comment and then our next two questions.
Bjorn, I just want to comment on the point about exponential growth. It depends on the rate of exponential growth, how quickly things grow. So renewables could dominate the energy system by mid-century if they grow fast enough. And certainly the renewables industry is geared up for very fast growth. So it's not quite as simple as we need to explore to satisfy demand for evermore.
Great. So then the woman over there, please, and then the gentleman in the front row.
Hello, my question is to Statoil. It's partially been answered, but it's still not very clear how much of a threat the development of renewable technology is to the oil industry, in the sense that will they be investing in the development of renewable technologies, or will they be continue to focus on fossil fuels because they see still the need, as you described, for the prevalence of fossil fuels to meet the energy demands of the future? Or are they going to look at what countries are doing and take a maybe a more ethical stance, and because of the pressure, and not just what the policy change might make them do, but in terms of actually the threat the development will have on their business models?
And the gentleman, thank you.
My question is actually very related by coincidence, so thank you. What I'm wondering is that it seems that one of the major restrictions to renewable energy development is insufficient capital. Oil and other fossil fuel industries have ample capital. I wonder if there is a chance that we could try to convert existing fossil fuel companies to begin developing renewable energies almost exclusively and use that capital for renewable purposes.
Thank you. So Bjorn, would you like to again start off?
Yeah, and then Susan? Yeah. So is it a threat? No. So we're part of that business ourselves, and we are putting a lot of our best engineers working with technology for renewables, even solar that we don't work with, again, we're not in. We deploy quite a lot of capital to renewables, but we make sure that when we invest in that, there is a business case, that, so we don't kind of waste other people's money. And what is positive now is that we see that some of the offshore wind projects, they compete on equal terms with the oil and gas projects. So the more better business it is, the more investments you will get in that direction. So it's not a threat, and we hope to see even more business opportunities for Statoil opening up. But be mindful, one of the reasons why renewables are attractive is because it's subsidized. So be... I'm sorry? Yeah, so that's a different debate on, at least for us, at least. No, but at least for us as a company, we do a 78% tax rate. So we don't feel it as a subsidy, but I know there's a lot of kind of petroleum subsidies going on in the world. And Statoil has taken a clear stance on it. Please get rid of it.
Susan, quick comment.
It must be a threat, because all the efforts that the oil and gas and nuclear industries and so on put into persuading governments to keep subsidising them and to slash the feed-in tariffs for renewables, as has just recently happened in this country. I think that just speaks volumes.
And Howard?
Yeah, I mean, I just want to go back to the question of what will happen to the fossil fuel companies. I mean, this is really very straightforward. If the world agrees that carbon emissions are going to come down at 2 or 3% a year rather than go up at 1% a year, then fossil fuel sales will come down at 3% a year rather than going on up. That means, eventually, fossil fuel companies will stop running themselves for expansion, they will cut their overheads, they will cut their research and development, and they will go into decline over a 30 or 40 year period. That won't make them necessarily less valuable. I mean, we need fossil fuels for a long time yet, and shareholders will like all the cash they throw off. but they will, at some point, change their business model from research, from exploration and expansion to gradual managed decline. If they don't, we're on our way to 4 degrees.
Great. So two questions in the middle. The woman with the orange and then the red.
Hello, my name's Becky Moorhood. I'm a research associate here at Imperial. And as a result of that, I've got my pension with the University Superannuation Scheme, USS. I just had a quick look at their website, and they've got about $300 million invested in renewables, but officially they have a stance against divestment. My question's quite a practical one, and it's really, how much can individual universities, like Imperial, for example, influence USS's national investment portfolio? And also, how much potential is there for them to individually divest their pension funds?
And the second question?
Well, my name is Borja. I'm a mechanical engineer, and I have been working in the Norwegian continental shelf. So my question is about, because we have been talking about everything, but we didn't talk about education, because at the end of the day, everyone wants to take a hot shower, ride the car, use energy, and, well, oil and gas is going to be there. We are going to continue using hydrocarbons. And I'm wondering, at this stage, hydrocarbons, the prices, they have been plummeting. They are so cheap. So renewable energies are not going to be profitable at these low prices. So what's the scenario for the renewable energies under these oil hydrocarbon prices? The projects will be developed. And,
great, thank you. So the first question was in relation to USS and their approach. Does anybody want to take that? I mean, I'm very happy to, because ShareAction is working with members of the USS scheme, and I think there's going to be an event here at Imperial later, I think it's next month, particularly to allow beneficiaries and future beneficiaries of USS to engage with the pension funds. So can I encourage you to look at the ShareAction website where there are details, or come to me and I can give you a card. The second, James, did you want to make a comment?
Just very briefly on that, I mean, it's your pension. You're a member of that pension fund, and you know, the trustees are acting in your interest. So if enough of you, and I appreciate it, it feels daunting because it's so huge, but you know, if enough of you go to them and say, this is what we want, then they have to provide it.
And we have a database of between 3,000 and 4,000 members of the scheme who are very interested in following up on both climate risk issues and other arms-related issues as well. So please have a look at the ShareAction website.
And we did a story a couple of weeks ago about public sector pensions, in particularly those run by local authorities, and you know, there's a similar situation there with you know, hundreds of millions invested around the country, and you know, obviously there are the members of those schemes, but you know, there's also with those a sort of democratic ownership, if you like. You know, people can, this is essentially taxpayers' money that is being paid, that, you know, that's where it comes from originally. So you know, all of us have a stake in that as well.
And Bjorn, did you want to come in on the second question?
Yeah, so I think that's a very good question. So what will happen to the renewables with the lower oil price? Will it be still be attractive to invest in renewables? The encouraging thing with renewables is that you've seen a tremendous development on the technology, so the cost is coming down. And what I think you should have in mind is that the oil and gas companies or energy companies at large, we have an investment horizon of 10, 20 years. So we don't look at the daily oil price as such. We have, you know, look at the longer term trends. And then what is really important is the cost position, the cost, because it's a cost game at the end. So it's really encouraging to see renewables costs coming down. I'm convinced it's going to be increasingly competitive. But the scale of change is so big that I think it will be a gradual change, that so we'd probably need a lot of sources of energy going forward. So then the gentleman on the first row here asked a very good question in the last round. And is there anything you can do to accelerate how companies are shifting their behavior towards less carbon intensive sources? And I think, yes, there is. And that is to put a price on carbon. Because there is a clear price on carbon, you get the pricing of carbon into the calculations, and you can make sound investments decisions on that. So, for instance, for us, it means that we can change the way we run our plants. We change operational procedures because there is a cost to wasteful use of energy. We can change the way we design our installations to maybe run one compressor instead of two, because there is a cost of having that redundancy or extra additional capacity or safety net that a dual compressor would offer you, or a turbine. Or we can decide, you know, we're not going to do oil and gas development, we're going to try to look for something else. So and that also helped us to decide that this giant oil development we're taking part of now will be electrified from the grid, not run by a gas compressor, and it's going to be electrified and run completely on renewable energy. So yes, but we need a price on carbon.
So we've actually gone over time, but as we started late, I'm going to take two more questions. One microphone is already out at the top, so if we can then pass it on to the second hand that's at the back there. In answering it, I'd like each of the panellists to make a very, very short final intervention. So the two questions at the back, there's one microphone. Great.
My questions
very
are
quick, please.
National oil companies. So 10% of the companies you know, BP, Shell, they compose 10% of the reserves in the world, but Saudi Aramco, big companies like that, compose 90%. And I think what worries me is, as an oil industry professional, I'd like to see it hit the national oil companies as well. And I don't know how you do that. My question is, how do you, if you divest in Shell, BP, you might increase the influence of these national oil companies, and you may accidentally give more influence to countries like Saudi Arabia, Dubai, Indonesia, in ways that you hadn't intended. I agree with the movement, but how you tackle that side of it is my question.
Great, and then just slight there. Brilliant, thank you.
Becca Biran in ET Index. My question is specifically to Björn, but I'd like to hear the whole panel's views on this. Increasingly, a lot of the fossil fuel majors are starting to talk the talk on climate change, taking on board the climate rhetoric, as we saw with Statoil in this debate. I'll take the Aiming for A coalition as a part of that. But can the companies walk the walk? We've had revelations in the recent week that Exxon has known about climate change since the early 1980s and helpfully decided not to tell anybody about it, but rather spent millions on lobbying against climate change legislation. We had revelations on Shell's political lobbying in Europe that gutted renewable energy targets that were meant to be implemented for 2030. So actually, even though the fossil fuel majors are talking the talk of climate change, are they willing to take substantial action that will essentially cannibalize their business models to create a transition to a world where we can still have a civilization?
Two great final questions, and the challenge to our panelists is to answer them very, very succinctly. So I'm going to start with Howard and then work our way across, if that's okay. Thank you.
Yeah. It's straightforward. The directors of fossil fuel companies have a fiduciary obligation to make money out of fossil fuels, so they will seek, in whatever legal ways they can, to delay a rapid energy transition. They have to do that, don't they? So that's the first question. The second question, the national oil companies have 90% of reserves. Yes, they do. And COP21 at Paris is part of getting is part of what you need to do to get countries to agree to reduce their dependence on fossil fuels. Divestment all helps put pressure on that process. And you want a final view. Can we do all of this? Can we get onto a 2-degree track? Yes, we can, but we have to get off our backsides and do stuff now.
Sagarika.
I just come back to one of Bjorn's comments. I think on carbon pricing, again, investors I've spoken with would really like to see a price put on carbon. It would help them better manage risk, and they would really like to see that in place. An international framework with regional linkages would be fantastic. And then on political lobbying, It is a real challenge. Again, here, as an investor who's taken the decision, perhaps not to divest, but instead to stay at the game of engaging in dialogue with companies, I believe you could have a real impact. So PRI has a specific investor group that's focused on political lobbying and that dialogue with companies, and to send a clear message that investors do not want to see their capital used lobbying against their long-term interests.
Susan.
I know that by divesting we can't deal with all the problems. I know that there's lots and lots of other things that need to be done in terms of developing new technologies, in terms of thinking about, well, how does one deal with things like the national oil companies? But from where we sit, as with the tools we've got available to us, we just, you know, we're convinced that we can influence through our investments, and we can influence even more through our grant making. That's our business. Some of you will be in other businesses. What you need to think about is, what can you do to influence this transition in any way that you can, in your work or in your private activist lives?
Bjorn.
Yeah, that was quite a challenge there. On the, so is this cosmetics only? Is it only doing the talking and then we do something else? I don't agree with you. I think we're trying really hard. And, you know, people in oil and gas companies, there are mothers and fathers and even former friends of yours from Imperial College. I trust them to work really hard on the challenge. They believe in the future in exactly the same way as you do. We are trying to disclose whatever we do, and we are really committed to respond in a very kind of responsible way. But of course, we need to manage some of the climate issues, and then we protect a lot of kind of capital there, in the shareholder interests. We also manage the natural resources of countries, and we create jobs, and, you know, maintain entire industries, and they have suppliers. So finding the right kind of balance, but still being very impatient in the way that we develop and transform the industry. That's where we're at. So, but I don't think this is a rhetorical thing only, not at all.
Thank you. I'm very privileged to be able to sort of bookend this debate by having the first word and the last word. So on the question of will companies walk the walk, I mean, I might be completely naive about this. Instead, I would say that I wouldn't put Statoil in the same, bracket as Exxon. Exxon are, off the scale evil, really, when it comes to, everything they've done over the years to obfuscate and delay and, fund climate denial, all the rest of it. But I guess my challenge to you, Bjorn, would be that, you understand the direction that we have to go in and how far we have to go. Your company has the resources to make a really significant difference. And, I might be completely naive, but wouldn't it be incredible if your company set out a sort of 20, 30-year vision about how you were going to transform yourself from an oil and gas company into an energy company that was not producing carbon emissions? Now, maybe that's by, aggressively developing CCS, or maybe that's by going completely renewable. But, that's, I think, the sort of vision that we need from the big oil and gas companies. I mean, the coal companies are one hopes, pretty stuffed, because there's, coal is just so carbon intensive. But it remains to be seen whether anyone will really pick up that challenge. But I just wanted to finish on a note of hope, which is, what the second phase of the Guardian's campaign is really about, and saying that the future is actually out there in some places and is already happening, and we just need to kind of make it happen faster. There was a blog post that appeared in Scientific American in March 2011 that was written by a computer scientist called Ramirez Nam. And he was pointing out that the cost of solar power was following Moore's law,
And you know, pointing out this is pretty exciting because solar was getting cheaper very quickly, and he was predicting if those trends continued, then solar by 2030 solar would cost 50 cents a watt. Now by the end of 2014, solar cost 36 cents a watt. So the costs are coming down much faster than people predicted, which is making solar power much more competitive much more quickly. And I think that's a reason to be much more optimistic than perhaps it sometimes feels like we should.
Brilliant. Well, I was asked to do a very, very brief summary, and I'm going to keep it very brief because you've heard from all the panelists the complexity of the discussion. I think there's no doubt in my mind that the divest invest movement has put climate risk on the agenda in a way that we haven't seen before, and it's created the space for others to move into it. So I think the whole investment industry has to respond to climate risk in a way that perhaps they didn't do before. And then to echo Howard's words, it's about action and action and hope. So at this point, I think I'm handing over to George, yes, the students to do a quick final summary. And again, thank you for organising the event tonight.
Okay, I'll just start by saying thank you to the panel. It's been an extremely interesting discussion, and just two things that struck me. Firstly, I completely agree with something Susan said, which was in that I am doing a PhD looking at the impacts of climate change, so I find it very difficult to be part of an organisation which is profiting essentially from climate change. It seems to be something that your organisation's found as well. As the debate's gone on, something that's kind of kept coming up has been return on investment and shareholder responsibility, fiduciary responsibility. It does kind of seem that the part of the problem is that the energy system is being run to provide energy, but also to provide profit to individuals. And that perhaps maybe we could get to a system where the energy system is run to provide energy, but also an environment for us all to live in. It's just something that struck me as we were talking.
Thank Susan for bringing up the People and Planet League, which Imperial are about 112th in. And clearly this whole issue, it's been great to have a debate on divestment, a discussion on divestment, but there's much more we can do as Imperial College students. We need to be taking a holistic approach to this. We need to be changing what and how we consume. We need to be pushing for the distribution of new energy systems, and we need to be considering our engagement with these economic systems. So it's a call to action and a call to join us in this push to get something happening here. Thank you.
As a final point, quick brief one, I had an email this morning from the USS, the University Pension Scheme, asking me my opinions about ethical investment. So you do have an opportunity to fill out that form, tell them what you think. And there's also a box for you to say which industries you don't think they should be investing in. So please go wild.